please turn to the second chapter of Hebrews, and we'll start out the 13th verse. And it says there, I will, and again, I will put my trust in him. And again, here am I and the children whom God has given me. And again, this is talking about Jesus who came down from heaven as the second person of the Godhead, as a man God. So, it's saying here that it's referring to Jesus. I will put my trust in him. Now, a lot of these passages, especially when you see them in quotes like this, that they're taken from the Old Testament. However, there is no exact quotation for this particular verse, and it's really a number of different passages that give the idea that we must trust Jehovah God. In 2 Samuel 22nd chapter verse 3, it says, the God of my strength in whom I will trust. And it goes on to say some other things too. Then in Psalms 18 verse 2, Lord is my rock, my fortress, my deliverer, my God, my strength in whom I will trust. And in Psalm 71st Psalm verse 5, for you are my hope, O Lord, Lord God, you are my trust, my youth. And then in the 40th Psalm, verse 4, blessed is the man who makes the Lord his trust. So it's a case that Jesus, as man, had to trust in God because he'd given up his exalted presence in heaven. Came down as a man. I don't see how one could do that, but he did it. And it's all because of the love that he had for us. And that was the only way that he could achieve the salvation of mankind. And it says here in verse 13, and again, here am I, the children whom God has given me. Now that's a quotation from, or at least allusion from Isaiah, the 8th chapter, verse 18. It said, here I am, the children whom the Lord has given me. We are for signs and wonders in Israel, from the Lord of hosts who dwells in Zion. And this, and it's said more about this, but this has to do with, you may not know it, but Isaiah had two sons. He may have had more children than just two, but he had two sons. And they were significant in what they represented. And one son was called, in we find that in Isaiah, the 7th chapter, verse 3. And if you want to correct my pronunciation, just go right ahead. The Lord said to Isaiah, go out now, meet Ahaz, you and Shear Jashub, your son, at the end of the pool and so forth. Well, of course, you know names in the Old Testament have a certain meaning. And Isaiah itself means salvation of Jehovah. But he had these two sons, and Shear Jashub, it meant a remnant shall return. And it had the idea that after, there's going to be a return from captivity of a remnant. So clearly it's alluding to the temporal nation of Israel, that and also Jacob, there's going to be a remnant that's going to return. But he had a second son also. And it said there that in verse 14 of Isaiah 7, he said, "The Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel." And we know in the New Testament that that has direct reference to Jesus himself. "But this particular child, curds and honey he shall eat, that he may know to refuse the evil and choose good. And before the child shall know to refuse the evil and choose good, the land that he led will be forsaken by both her kings." So it's alluding to the captivity. "The Lord will bring the king of Assyria upon you and your people and your father's house. And days that have not come since the day that Ephraim departed from Judah." We go down to the 8th chapter, and we see there that Isaiah is talking that I went to the prophetess, and she conceived and bore a son. So apparently, at the time of this writing in the 7th chapter, he had not had that son yet. "And the Lord said to me, call his name Mahershalal Hashbaz, for the child shall have knowledge to cry my father and my mother, the riches of Damascus and so forth, shall be taken away before the king of Assyria." Now that particular name means haste to the spoils, and it seemed to refer to the release of Israel from these two enemy kings, Rezin and Pekah, and one is king of Assyria, and the other is king of nation that's not Assyria, Syria, I think. They were threatening to overthrow the nation, and that threat of invasion was thwarted. And of course, eventually, it was invaded. It says there was a plea to Emmanuel. Again, a plea to Emmanuel. So the idea here is that the first son sort of alluded to the temporal nation, and the second son is referred to as Emmanuel. It's got to be the spiritual nation, that's coming. And certainly this is the case, you know, when Hebrews is talking about the nation, you have the temporal nation that was, you know, Jerusalem and the surrounding areas, that temple nation. But Jesus came down in the form of man, and he represented something entirely different, a nation for sure, but a spiritual nation. He represented a spiritual nation. So that's the allusion to my children. Here I am and the children whom God has given me. Inasmuch then, verse 14, then as the children have partaken of flesh and blood, he himself likewise shared in the same, that through death he might destroy him who has the power of death, that is the devil, and release those who through fear of death were all their lifetimes subject to bondage. Now, the children of the temple nation, of course, flesh and blood. In order to save those children, he, that's Jesus himself, had to share in the same, that is, the flesh, flesh. But he still made God. And he lived as a perfect individual, no sin. That through that life and the death that he experienced as a result of living the life of flesh, through that death and then the eventual resurrection, of course, he's going to destroy him who had the power of death. That's the devil. The devil is going to be destroyed. Now those who had fear of death, all their lifetime subject to bondage, now, and we're talking about the Hebrew Christians. And if you think about the Mosaic system, it was a system of death. There was only condemnation under the Mosaic system. And there's nothing that one could do through that system to inherit eternal life. It had to be through the blood that was shed by Jesus Christ. So the Hebrew Christian, if he was looking again to go back into the Mosaic system, was going back under a system of death. They feared the death of that system, that there was no salvation in it. They were subject to bondage, but yet they were thinking about going back under that system. So it was only through the spiritual system, the new system that is ushered in by Jesus himself, it was only through there that they had release from this fear of death. And it says, verse 16, "For indeed he does not give aid to angels, but he does give aid to the seed of Abraham." Now, here's a lesson in Revelation. The King James says he did not take on the nature of angels. And American Standard says he does not give help to angels. The interesting thing is that in the Greek, none of those words appear. It is not in the Greek at all. What is there is the idea of laying hold on something and not letting go. And you can see this same word or phrase, same phrase is used in 1 Timothy 6, chapter verse 12 and verse 19, which says lay hold on eternal life. You know, grab hold, hold on eternal life and don't let go. Well, so why does King James say nature and ESV say help and New King James say is aid? It is an appropriate idea anyway. That Jesus took on, did not take on the nature of angels, but he took on the nature of men. Now, why did he take on the nature of men, not angels? Because he was here to give aid to men and not angels. So even though the exact word is not used in the Greek, the idea comes across that Jesus came to live this life to give, took the nature of human in order to help him, in order to aid him. So he says he does give aid to the seed of Abraham. In verse 17, therefore, in all things he had to be made like his brethren, that he might be a merciful and a faithful high priest. But keep in mind at this point in time, you know, while he was here on earth, he was not a high priest. He was not a king. He was to become that, but he wasn't that yet. But he had to be like his brethren, that is, live the life of the flesh and be tempted like his brethren were tempted. Yet without sin, he had to do that in order that when he did become a high priest, he might be faithful to their cause to help them, and merciful because he knew what their temptations were like.
Ken,
yes, sir.
You have a divine commentary on this, Paul, in the letter to Philippians chapter 2. He's discussing the same thing. And he is talking about the mind of Christ, the Lord being us. Philippians 2, verse 5. Then he says, which has been elaborated on, and is not as detailed in Hebrews as here. He says, who being in the form of God, or not robbery, but the hell on your grasp, equal with God. But made himself of no reputation. How do you do that? And took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, humbled himself, became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. That's exactly what the writer of Hebrews is about to talk about. But Paul goes into this more detail. And form is what he gave up. He gave up the form of the deceased. He gave up the form of the and he took hold of himself in humanity.
I think we sometimes have a problem with the word robbery. And the ASV really is the idea. It's not something that you just grasp.
It's about to be grasped.
ASV says grasp. But I've always wondered, it's always amazed me how someone who is enjoys the presence of heaven could give it up.
But it wasn't that he just gave up heaven.
Yeah.
He gave up the very form of death. God gave him the people. Jesus did.
Yeah.
So he had to put himself into a position.
God can't die either. But Jesus could.
But the Spirit, which is deep, he didn't. And that's the reason that in the form of humanity, like all of us are, that's the reason he could be perfect. Because his Spirit was the second person of God.
I've always wondered, and I don't know if there's an answer to it, that Jesus, before he died, he obviously knew that he was, that this had happened. He had occupied heaven and gave it all up, become a man. He obviously knew that. And, you know, because God, when he had been baptized, you know, the dove came down. This is my beloved son. So he knew that. But when did he know it? Don't know. But he still, even though he may have known that, he still did it. He still could have been, he still could have yielded to temptation, but did it.
Christ had to grow as a human. He didn't have to grow as God.
Yeah.
He had to grow as a human. And thus, whatever his humanity allowed him to do, growing from him, or from his conception of the Holy Spirit, being born, and then growing till he was old enough to go down to the temple. Yes, there was growth and development in him as a human. But he knew by the time he got to the temple what was going on.
He knew by that time.
So there had to be the development of the human part of it.
Yeah.
It wasn't the development of the deity. It didn't develop.
I just hope that we, in our studies, come to an appreciation of what he had to give up. And what he did on our behalf, because we couldn't do it ourselves. Only God could do it.
Well, the thing that even though God had is once he gave it up, he's never that way again.
Yeah, that's right.
He remains glorified man. So how far did he go to take us to heaven?
And tell us exactly what glorified man looks like. I don't know either, but it's different.
Well, the thing about it is, he remained man.
Yeah.
Paul said to Timothy, there's one mediator between God and man.
Man, Jesus Christ.
Well, that's how you said the right hand of God ruling back then.
Yeah.
But he glorified man. But all that's saying is he's the first fruits from the dead, and I'm the Lord.
things that we just, as a finite human mind, we can't grasp. Now, we can intellectually state it, but what does it really mean?
That's
reading
it
to be
faithful, so when you get there, you look.
Well, we need to be, we can intellectually state it on the basis of the knowledge that we gain from His Word, intellectually gather that we trust it, and we remain obedient to it. And then at some point in time, we'll know. Well, not time, but some point. That's one thing I can say. That's about time. Then it becomes something else at the time.
Those things are worthy of a whole lot of thought just to see what it means. It says, for God so loved the world.
Yeah. We read over the scene very quickly. And it's repeated so often that we kind of memorize it. But do we know what it means?
That's the reason that the judgment for those who have spurned their time on earth to embrace what all the good heaven.
Well, that's what the writer of Hebrews tells these Hebrew Christians, you better spend your time, dwelling on the Word of God. You better do that.
The Lord is rich thoughts, and I was thinking about Philippians when you read that, but he's discussing from a different angle the same thing in Philippians.
Yeah. Anyway, where was it? Therefore, in all things, he had been made like his brethren. Now, keep in mind, he's talking to these Hebrew Christians. And when he's talking about his brethren, Jesus was a Jew. He had been made like, I'm sure that would give them a lot of comfort to know that Jesus was like them. And by being like them, he could be merciful. And faithful, outreach. Now, what reaction they had when they read this faithful high priest? They knew that Jesus could not be high priest under the Mosaic system. And whether they had, but he's introducing the concept, and he's going to dwell, he's going to expand on that concept later, especially later on. Chapter 5 and so forth, he's going to expand on that concept of being a high priest and other things too. And we just can say right here that he was not a high priest while he walked the earth. He was not a king while he walked the earth. Yeah, it will say here a bit later that he was also an apostle and a high priest. Well, he could be an apostle while he walked the earth, because apostle, Barnabas was called an apostle. He was not one of the 12, but he was called an apostle. So that's the generic use of the term. Apostle is just, say a messenger or ambassador, somebody that's speaking for another. So Jesus is here, he's speaking on behalf of God the Father himself. So in that sense, while he was here, walked the earth, he was an apostle bringing a message and representing God from on high. But he was not a high priest or a king. And we'll get into the concept of high priest later, what that really involved. Just suffice it to say that for now, he was not, while he walked the earth, he was not a high priest or king. It's verse 18. It says, faithful high priest and things pertaining to God to make propitiation for the sins of the people. He was able to do that because of the sacrifice of himself, the blood that he shed. He was able to do that because, to have one's sin remitted, even under the Old Testament system, even though sins were not ultimately remitted, there had to be shedding of blood for sins. And so Jesus shed his own blood in order to be the propitiation for the sins, the blood sacrifice for sins. Nothing else would do. For in that, verse 18, for in that he himself has suffered, being tempted, he is able to aid those who are tempted. Well, he certainly suffered. Nobody can deny that. And he certainly was tempted, yet without sin. Nobody can deny that. But because of that, because he successfully resisted temptation, he's able to help those who are tempted and to give them strength. And also those who actually yield to temptation, he offers a means to absolve themselves of that sin in their lives. Let's see here. I'm looking for verse 19. There's no verse 19. In verse 1 of chapter 3, it says, therefore, holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling, consider the apostle and high priest of our confession, Christ Jesus. Now you can call him an apostle and high priest now, because this is already after his ascension to heaven, so when this is written, he is the high priest. And he is the king. And his message is still being delivered by the apostles. Apostles to Christ, delivering the message of the Christ, the apostle. He's the high priest of our confession, as the King James would say, profess something to be true. And so you might just think that we must always profess our confession. It must be continued. You must never give up on that. The heavenly calling, what is the heavenly calling? Well, you know, you look at 1 Corinthians, the 7th chapter, verse 17, talking about the Lord has called each one. And in Philippians, the 3rd chapter, verse 13 and 14, Paul talks about his upward call of God in Christ Jesus. And in 1 Corinthians, 1st chapter, verse 2, talking about called to be saints. And in Romans, the 1st chapter, verses 6 and 7, again it says they're called to be saints, called of Jesus Christ. Well, how are we called? If we're called to be these saints, how are we called? In 2 Thessalonians, the 2nd chapter, verse 14, it says you are called by the gospel. Gospel is God's power to save. That's how we're called. And there is no other way that we are called. There's no little voice. There's no one appears to be dream. You don't have vision. You're called by the gospel. So if you don't ever look at the gospel, kind of frustrate the attempts of the gospel to call you. So you have to get into the gospel. That is the last will and testament of Jesus Christ. You have to get into that gospel in order to be called. And it will, if you approach it honestly and fairly, it will challenge your thinking. And if you rightly divide the word of truth, then there's only one response that you can make to the gospel, to yield to it, and become obedient to its message. Yeah, let's see where I have a verse 2. Who was faithful to him who appointed him, as Moses was also faithful in all his house. And then we're talking more about Moses, but he was faithful to him who appointed him. Well, who appointed him? Well, Jesus was faithful to him, if that's the Heavenly Father, and that's appointed him to be the Savior of the world. But Moses was faithful to his house. And when you say Moses' house, it would be also the house of Jehovah God also, but Moses was responsible for that house, the nation of Israel, and he was faithful to that house, just as Jesus is faithful to the house of the new Jerusalem. He's faithful to that house. He says, 2 Timothy 4, verse 7, Paul said, I fought the good fight, finished the race, and kept the faith. So, Jesus was faithful to the one appointed him. Moses was faithful to the nation of Israel. Paul was faithful. He kept the faith, the one that was delivered, once delivered to the saints. In verse 3, for this one had been counted with more glory than Moses, inasmuch as he who built the house has more honor than the house. The builder should always have more honor than the house itself. And this one, of course, talking about Jesus, and keep in mind, these are Hebrew Christians. They know about Moses. They know what he's done. They know his significance under the Mosaic system. They know all that. But this one has been counted worthy of more glory than Moses. He's superior to Moses. But yet these Hebrew Christians were thinking about going back under that system. And he expresses a truism here that he who built the house has more honor than the house itself. So the nation of Israel, God has more honor than the nation of Israel. Jesus Christ, he, if you talk about the church as his house, the New Jerusalem, the spiritual Jerusalem, he's the one that built that, and he has more honor than that house. In verse 4, for every house is built by someone, but he who built all things is God. And we'll start there